So now we are, today we are very pleased to receive Adeline Martinez, who is a PhD researcher at Aix-en-Provence in France. And she's now conducting her research at Java in Indonesia on the Merapi volcano. So she will talk about semantic, like she works on semantics like natural disasters and the question of resettlement of the population living near living in the volcano. So please.
Hello, everybody. I first have to thank the Center of Social Development Studies at EAC to invite me here. And as Abigail Pesses say, I work on, I'm a specialist on population resettlement. I work on a small village located in the south of Merapi, who have been totally destroyed and resettled by the government after 2010. So I will say something because maybe as you have already seen, I changed my title. My first title was Understanding an Active Volcano, Naturalism and Animism in Central Javanese Society. Actually, when I was preparing this seminar, I started to analyze my ethnographic data in the light of the work of Philippe Descola, and it appeared that some facts, ritual practices or representation and conception related to environment are more close to analogism than animism. This is why today I prefer to discuss these three modes of identification. So, to present the context of my research, I work on this village called Pelamsari. This is the new village, so after the resettlement. As I said, it was destroyed, totally destroyed by a major eruption in 2010. And here you can see the new resettlement site. It's a village of 81 households. This village is also famous because this is where lives the guardian of the volcano, say Chu Kunchi in Javanese. The guardian of the volcano is a servant of the royal palace of Yogyakarta. Yogyakarta is a city located close to the Merapi volcano, around 30 kilometers from the volcano. And so the mission of the guardian is to conduct the annual ceremony of offering to Merapi volcano and more broadly to maintain good relationship with the mountain. Here, this is the map of Central Java. So, this is the city of Yogyakarta, which is located in the south of Merapi Mountain. And this is the province of Yogyakarta. Yogyakarta is a sultanate, but the king is also the governor of the region. This province has a big density of population, around 1 million inhabitants in Yogyakarta, and the density population density at the Merapi flanks is around 1,000 inhabitants per kilometer square. The that is quite high for a rural region. So this is the Merapi volcano. It's located, as you see, in the center of the island of Java, at almost 3,000 meters above the sea level. Merapi volcano is considered as permanently active. So here you can see to understand the tectonic logic of Indonesia. Merapi volcano is located on the Ring of Fire, where Indo-Australian plate met the Eurasian plate. This is why there is more than 140 volcanoes in Indonesia. And Merapi volcano is one of the main dangerous due to its really active character and due to the population density, population density. There is two main hazards relative to the Merapi volcano. The first one on the left, this is lahar. Lahar is a flow of volcanic debris. When it's raining a lot, flowing water carry volcanic rocks, sand along the valley and river. This kind of flow can destroy everything on this pass. So in this photo, this is one of the main river in the south of the volcano called Kali Gendol. So as you can see, the debris of lahar have completely destroyed a dam. And the second hazard, this is pyroclastic flow, or nuar dont in French. In Indonesian, it's called awan panas, and in Javanese, wedis kimber. A pyroclastic flow is a flow of high temperature volcanic rocks, ashes, and gases. This kind of flow can go down the flank of the volcano with a speed of 300 km per hour. This is this phenomena which destroyed the Balansari village in 2010. The Merapi is a very active volcano, as I said. Here you can see the major eruptions since 1872, since they start to record the eruption actually, with an average of beating quite high. The last one in 2010 made more than 300 beating. So, it's what about the context. Today, I want to explore with you the different representation of volcanic environment in the light of the work of Philippe Descola, Beyond Nature and Culture. So he defines in his book different of what he called mode of identification. He distinguished four modes, but today I will consider three of them. The first one is naturalism. So according to Philippe Descola, naturalism is stand on a dualism between nature and culture. There is a continuity in physicality between human and non-human, but the difference of interiority between both. For him, modern sciences are the typical expression of this mode of identification. Naturalism is different from analogism, which considers that the world is made with numerous and various elements, all different in physicality and interiority. And the third one I will consider today, this is animism. Animism can be resumed when humans consider non-human elements as having the same interiority as human, like conscience, So to do that, today I will take two examples. The first one, this is the Volcanic State Surveillance Agencies and scientists. And the second one, this is the annual offering ceremony to Merapi Volcano. Nowadays, state surveillance agencies have two main goals. The first one is to anticipate volcanic eruption in the context of risk mitigation policy. And the second one is doing research about the volcano to better understand this phenomena. Because volcanoes stay always a mysterious phenomena for scientists. The creation of the first volcano surveillance agency was during the colonization. After an eruption of Kelud volcano in East Java, colonial power created the Institut Volcanologie. Before the independence, volcano surveillance agency are growing beside natural conservation policies, such as in 1912, the creation of National Park of Mount Merapi. After this date, Sweden agriculture was forbidden in the park of Merapi, and Merapi people, as the ancestor of people of Kurumsari village, have to remove their subsistence activity downstream. This is at this time that we can say the nature of moderns, as Philippe Descola say, clearly appears in Indonesia. So it appears, nature of moderns appears during the colonization. So, naturalism is entering in Indonesia through state power and through two axes, conserving and protecting nature. And the second one is protect culture or society from dangerous volcanic nature. So, here, this is a map of the current observatory in Mount Merapi, who have been built during this period, the colonial period, and they are still used for volcanic surveillance. So you have five main observatories. Later I will speak about Babadan, located in the west of the volcano. After the independence, in Yogyakarta is created the Pengawasan Gunung Merapi, which means surveillance agency of Merapi volcano, which became later the current Pengkembangan Teknologi Kebencanaan Geologi, or PPTKG. So more about the techniques used to anticipate volcanic phenomena. So there are several techniques, such as seismography, tilt meter, temperature of fumarole, direct visual observation, flange deformation, etc., etc. There's so many techniques. These techniques inform us that about the representation of the volcano from the scientists and state agency. Do they really see the volcano as a geophysical entity from which humans try to catch several signals? So, with this signal in the goal of risk management, scientists identify prone risk area with prediction model and mathematic model. They try to isolate a dangerous nature. So, as the plan of resettlement is clearly marks this goal of remove human dwelling from risk area. Here, this is the current risk zone map, used for risk mitigation. I don't know if you can see in red in here. This is the prone risk area. It is totally forbidden to live inside this area, where it's considered like too dangerous. So, as we can see, a clear border appear in this map, clear separation between culture, society, and nature, volcano. This is exactly the same logic as the one used for nature conservation and forest conservation, which separate a nature to protect from humans' activity. The Merapi volcano is famous in Indonesia because of its permanent activity and in its dangerous character. But it's also famous for the place it takes in the cosmology of Yogyakarta Kingdom. The more emblematic expression is the central place of Merapi volcano of the ceremony of Labuhan, performed once a year for the anniversary of the accession of the Sultan of the province. To speak about the origin of ceremony, it is not really clear because there is no written trace or archive about this ceremony. We just can find a myth of origin in the Javanese royal chronicle called Baba Tanajawi. That is a very famous story, and we can see that this story is one part of the corpus of the local storytelling, actually. So, this is a story. So, it is a story of Senopati, the first king of the current dynasty of Yogyakarta, around 17th century. Who fell in love with the goddess of southern sea named Ratu Kidul. Senopati received as a gift an egg from his lover, but because the king was scared about becoming a spirit if he eat the eggs, so he asked to his gardener named Kijurutaman to eat it. Kijurutaman, as expected, became a spirit, and Senopati gave him the mission to protect the kingdom of Mataram. Mataram, this is the name of the current dynasty. And Kijurutaman take place in the Merapi volcano. Kijurutaman took the name of Kyai Sapu Jagar, then became minister of the kingdom of Merapi volcano. This kingdom is ruled by two brothers named Ampu Rama and Ampu Bernadi. Sapu Jagar became the one in charge of the army, and in charge of the volcanic activity of the mountain. Since this time, each sultan of the kingdom have to give offering to Sapujagan and the other spirit of Merapi volcano to thank them for the sacrifice of Kijoru Taman and for their protection against lava and pyroclastic flow. During Labuhan, Royal Palace sent offering in three different places. In the beach of Parangkusumo, which is located in the south, in the east on Labu volcano, and every 8 years, offerings are made in a fourth point on the Dipli River located in the west. So the ceremony places the royal palace in the center of a cosmological system ordered by relative cardinal point. So I don't know if you can read, but here this is the prayer, the official prayer, said to by the guardian of the volcano during the offering ceremony. I just want to show that in this prayer, the recipient are God, Allah, because almost everybody in Central Java is Muslim, and also for the spirit of the volcano. So I will read this prayer. Labuhan Dalem in Mount Merapi, the Kraton, this is the royal palace of Nyayogyakarta Adigigrat, Sri Amen Kubuwono X, this is the name of the current sultan. Thanks to Allah for the grace and the joy He gives to us, to me and to all, so that we can meet here. I am carrying out my mission in the name of Naso Dalem, Sampeyan Dalem, Inkan Sinwon, Konjain Sultan, Amen Kubuwono Senobati, Engalomo, Abdurrahman Khalifatullah, Inkan Jumene, and Nyonyakata. This is the complete name of the Sultan. I am conducting the Labuhan Dalem ceremony in Mount Merapi with this offering, and now we make a list of all the offering. All this offering is for Eyang Sapujagag. So Sapujagag, this is the Minister of Army. Eyang Ampur Ramadi, no, this is the King of Merapi. Brahma Dedali, Nyani Gadum Melati, Eyang Megantoro, Panambaan Prabhu Jagat, Parlopari, Pranjan Kawat, Krifchin Wesi. Donc, all these names, this is the main spirit who is living in Merapi Kingdom. After the gift of this offering, I'm asking the blessing of Allah, may the Sultan have a long life, as well as his wife, his children, and all his family. May people of Yogyakarta prosper. May Allah give us what we are asking to me and to everyone here. So according to Merapi inhabitant as well as palace servant, the royal palace, Kato, in here, is located on the north-south axis, which represented the link between invisible kingdom of the kingdom of Ratu Kidul is located in the Indian Ocean, and this is the spiritual link with the kingdom of Merapi. So as you can see, the royal palace is in the middle of these two kingdoms. Here, this is the representation of this axis. Look, I found it in the royal palace museum. So this is Merapi volcano, This is the Royal Palace, and as you can, we can guess that this axis is continuing on the south. Merapi Kingdom and Ratukidul Kingdom are conceptualized by using the same model as human world. It's mean like Merapi is like a royal palace. It's a crater with its king, minister, army, and common people. Common people have the same activities as human, like raising cattle, as Merapi people do, for example. And when someone disappears in the volcano, it is thought that this person has been requited by the kingdom of Merapi for some needs. More broadly, several authors, as Timothy Berendt, have analyzed the crater, the royal palace, as an attempt to identify inside a limited structure the unlimited universe. In other words, the royal palace is a representation of the macrocosm inside a microcosm. The crater is considered as a center which maintains the general equilibrium between the human world and the divine world. Harmony between both worlds are dependent on the conservation of a good relationship between them. It means that every perturbation in this relation can produce loss and destruction in both worlds. From that point of view, Labuhan's ceremony is one expression of the willingness of harmony between macrocosm and microcosm. According to Denis Lombard, India had an important influence in the construction of conception related to the royal power and the mountain. But for this French historian, cults of mountain have existed in Bali and Java before the Indo-Buddhist period. This was later that this cult have been mixed with the Brahmic and Buddhist conception of Mount Meru, the center of the universe, and the related notion of Maharaja as the lord of the mountain. According to the myth of origin of Merapi volcano, before its creation, the island of Java was not in balance. This is because of the creation of Merapi that the island can finally find its equilibrium and harmony. So, it means that Merapi stands in the center of the island of Java as Meru, cosmic Meru, is in the center of the world. So, when we consider the Labuhan ceremony, the light and its signification in the light of the work of Philippe Descola, several factors indicate an analogic system, such as the use of offering, the same organization, social organization between human world and spirit world, the significance of symmetry, for example, through the north-south axis, and the important role of making correspondences between micro and macrocosm. Maybe we can interpret this fight in the light of the influence of India during several centuries in the archipelago, because for Philippe Descola, India is a caste system, is a typical expression of an analogic system. But we still can find ritual practices and representation of environment which can be defined as more animic. Let's see. I've noticed in my in the village of Pelansari, the significance of territorial spirit in the daily life of the villagers. For example, here we have the Denden Kalir ritual. Denden means prepare, maintain, making beautiful, and Kali means river. So the goal of this ritual is to ensure the access of water to the inhabitants by giving offering to the guardian spirits of water sources. These spirits are very important for the social reproduction of the village, because when people want to marry, they need to make offering to the spirit and ask protection to them, protection for the marriage ceremony, but in general, protection and blessing for the spouses and the life as a future couple. So without the spirit, there is no social reproduction. Now, for villagers in Merapi, environment is habiting with a variety of spirit called makhluk halus. They can live in the trees, in volcanic rocks, springs, river, etc. So potentially every element of the natural environment can be considered as possessing an interiority similar to the human one. We can interact with them, and more than interact, humans have to maintain a good relationship with them to ensure human stability and reproduction. But physicality of this entity is unclear. It is existing a possibility of metamorphosis. As Philippe Descola say and think, metamorphosis is one of the characteristics of the expression of animic conception. For example, in Java, some person can become an animal, as Jean-Marc de Grave has described it about this famous champion of Carlton called Harry Moti, who had the capacity to turn himself into a panther or a tiger, a snake or a gorilla. But in Java, we can also find ritual of possession, such as the Jatilan dance or Kudalupin dance. The Jatilan is a trance dance. This kind of dance can be organized for many occasions. Its general purpose is to thank God, bersyukur in Indonesian. So I will show an example of this dance. It was organized in the village of Pelansari for the Independence Day, the 17th August 2015. So you will see on the video, at the start of the dance, before a dancer is entering, our seeds, food and drink are blessed by prayer and incense. They call the spirit to come, actually. The man in charge of this prayer, called Dukun, asks blessing from God, the spirit, and the dead. The dead are believed living all around humans. And you will see after 45 minutes dancing, some dancers are entering in a state of trance. They are told being possessed by spirits. So, you will see that this spirit is asking some food to the humans. But food is not necessarily food, it can be a good smell, coconut water, or animals. Let's see. in state of stress. So here they ask some food. Here this is incense. Spirit look like animals. He wants, we give to the spirit a live chicken and he will eat it. This man is really possessed by the spirit because as all inhabitants in the village, they are all Muslim. And I don't know, for Muslim, blood is considered as haram. Muslims are not allowed to consume blood. He consumes fresh blood, so it's not him actually. It's another spirit, another entity. Exist in Java, the dead can enter in the human body to deliver a message, for example. Dead can deliver a message about volcanic eruption too. So when we're considering the existence of metamorphosis and position in Java, I'm not sure we can actually classify this expression of representation of environment as totally analogic or totally animic. But we can retain that in the flank of the volcano, in an official way with Labuhan ceremony or in a local way with the ritual of Dendengali or Jatilan, it appears a very important necessity to feed the spirit of Merapi and local spirits, and the ancestor too. Because they are a part of the environment of the human, and so maintaining good relationship with them is central to ensure stability and reproduction of the human world. Philippe Descola says that in animism, human and non-human can construct relation of communication because they own the same interiority. It is actually possible in the flank of Merapi volcano. I've met several persons who told me that they received clear message alarming from an imminent eruption, from an ancestor, from a spirit, or sometimes it's more like a dream, like a metaphor that we need to be, which need to be interpreted. So humans and non-humans can communicate. Humans can receive crucial information for their safety. This is maybe why it is so important to maintain good relationship with non-human, because this relationship is a necessary condition of the communication and is the condition to receive important message about Merapi volcano. when I was speaking to the guardian of the volcano about dreams, he explained to me the concept of alam in Indonesian, in Javanese. We can translate alam by nature, but it's also referred to universe, world, realm. The guardian of the volcano explained that human beings are living in a fourth nature, which is concrete, and that human can see and experiment. But in parallel, there is a second nature, an invisible nature. So he told me, when humans receive dreams, they actually receive message from this second nature. Most of the time, this nature stays invisible for human. So, basically, in Javanese, nature is plural, and natures are interconnected, they can communicate. I've presented two different ways of representation and thinking about volcanic environment. So one, naturalism carried by state institution and scientist, and the other one, which is situated between animism and analogism. But actually, these two modes of identification are coexisting in present day, in the Central Javanese Society. They are actually coexisting even inside the same person as the guardian of the volcano. This is why in this last part of my communication, I want to discuss with you the possibility of their cohabitation and how one ontology can be integrated into another to create a meaningful world. So, naturalism and animism or analogism appear to be opposites. It's particularly clear with these two maps. As I explained earlier, the risk zone maps make a separation between the dangerous nature from the human dreaming zone. It makes a clear border between both. Whereas at the north-south axis, using as a reference for the Labuhan ceremony, highlights the link between humans and non-humans. And Labuhan ceremony actually takes place in the prone risk area in Indonesia. So we can say that one makes separation and the other one creates a link. But the goal of both ontology is to catch signal from the volcano in order to keeping the human world safe. They have the main goal. But the main difference is that in naturalism, people don't really communicate with this entity. They catch signals by using instruments and observation. In naturalism, we cannot communicate because they don't conceptualize volcano as possessing the same interiority. This is why I call this relationship a one-way relationship. Whereas it is actually possible to communicate and even necessary to establish communication between human and non-human world in the animic analogy. Ontology. Humans can interact with the volcano, and humans can have and humans' activity can have a real impact on the volcano. This is enough clear with the important role of the propitiatory ritual as the Labuhan. This is why I prefer to call this relationship in animism analogism perspective as a dialogue relationship with dialogue with environment. The last point I want to discuss with you is just a personal reflection, and I hope we can speak about that later. It is about a tendency which emerged in both ontology. This is a tendency to integration of concept of element from one ontology into another one. For example, in naturalism perspective carried by scientists, the local worldview of the volcano is integrated into the dualism nature-culture. For geographer, disaster management agents, they speak about cultural perception of nature or social perception of risk of volcano. So it means that analogism and animic practice are becoming a part of the culture, and they have to be integrated in disaster management plan for a better efficiency. But we have this tendency of integration in the analogic and animic perspective too. For example, there is some people who give offering to the seismic station on the volcano. Or they can make meditation in the observatory of Babadan in the west of the volcano. Scientific sites in the volcano are becoming preferred places to communicate with the volcanic entity and the spirits. So it means that at the end, scientific sites are embedded into a specific way of seeing and thinking environment. Another example, sometimes people have justified the usefulness of animic analogic practices with science. When I was doing the ethnography of Labuhan ceremony in the Royal Palace of Yogyakarta, I interviewed a member of the royal family who explained the usefulness of the ceremony of Labuhan by quoting several scientific articles about the memory of water and the impact of human action on water composition. He told me, if humans can influence water composition, why they cannot influence the volcano? Because the volcano is a mountain, and every mountain is an aquifer, a water reservoir. I, for the moment, don't really can explain this tendency to integration, to find bridge between both ontology and to create a meaningful world. But it's not an equal integration, because one ontology always takes the organizing structure of thinking, whereas the other one is just an element of the expression of the main ontology. So it's not equal, it's always included into the main ontology. To conclude, I just want to say that for me it was difficult to analyze current practices in Java about relation to environment in the light of in the frame of Philippe Descola. Maybe because it's more like a mix between several ontologies. And maybe because I don't know what you think, but in this book, the book of Philippe Descola, he don't work or speak too much about Southeast Asia. I think maybe in Southeast Asia we can see this particularity of a mix of several influence and way of thinking. If I should make an hypothesis, I think that maybe analogism is an heritage from the Hindu-Buddhist period, whereas animism is maybe a part of what Denis Lombard called the ancient Javanese background. And the opposite, naturalism in Indonesia is quite new because it's appeared with colonization. So, if it is quite clear that the idea of nature, the modern nature, is historically constructed, I'm not sure that the theory of the main mode of identification can totally explain the multiplicity of worldview and representation and environment about the world. But I hope you have an opinion about that too, and we can discuss that. Thank you very much.
Very interesting. Do you have some questions? Do you have any questions? Or commentary?
Thank you very much for a wonderful talk. I just have a question. I'm not a pro-scientific way of thinking, but why, in your opinion, why the natural or scientific way of seeing or understanding the volcano is a problem today? Is it a problem in the contemporary world with the zoning and everything that we have talked about? Do you see any problem in that, in keeping people safe or in keeping, like, I don't know, what is your opinion?
If there is some problem, it's maybe when I think about resettlement, because people are not allowed to live in the risk area, but actually people of Polonsari need to go to this area to live. So I can see maybe the problem is here by thinking nature outside of the human world. They don't completely integrate the fact that there is some people who actually need the volcano, they need the risk, and they need the forest, like that. Maybe some problem can appear here.
I have a question about the science. You said in the naturalist vision, there is a kind of one-way communication, so the scientist analyzes, they don't really have the communication with the invisible world or people or spirits living in the volcano, because they don't believe in it. But they use signs to communicate or to see how, when there will be an eruption. So can we think that these signs are ways of communication? I was just wondering of this because it's what you said in your presentation, that we have the impression that with naturalism there is only one way of, in fact, no communication.
There
no dialogue. And science could be considered as a way of dialoguing. They have signs to detect the activity of the volcanoes, and maybe you could study what is also considered as an efficient sign for them, or...
This is it was actually what I want to explain. The Merapi volcano for scientists is producing some sound. And I speak about one-way relationship because scientists just catch this sign, but they don't send some sign. It's not a real dialogue in this term of the discussion, I mean. But when we study the techniques, or observation techniques, it's not really true. For example, to understand what is inside the volcano, some scientists, I know French one who do that, he sends seismic sign inside the volcano. It's like the dolphin technique of communication. So he sends seismic sign. And after, when seismic sign met rocks or whatever, the sign is coming back. So it's more, when we study the technique, the observation technique, it looks like more like communication. But I don't think scientists think that spirit, Merapi volcano are interpreted and answer to their message. Maybe this is the difference.
Yeah. And another, well, it's interesting to compare these signs, I think, this way of communicating or non-communicating. Also, what are the signs that the people, you said, you talk about the dreams, but did they were informed before volcanic eruption? Do you have, you know, talks about this or
from the narratives state or
narratives about people saying that they could predict a volcano eruption with some sign they received?
Yeah, actually, there is more several people who told me they can do that because they received message. So maybe four or three, five people I met like that, they say, I dream about that before it happened, so I can interpret it in this way. And the former guardian of volcano, he was like considered like a really powerful spiritual man, and he often received this kind of dream to and interpret it like an eruption is coming, but it's not function every time an eruption is coming.
Okay, it's not working, I'm gonna speak up. Yeah, I wanted to come back to your last point about, you know, how the scientific centers are used by the local people. I was wondering if you like met some of the scientists and to see from what background they're from. Were they from like the same place? And did they share some of the beliefs, or were they from like other parts of the country? And like trying to cope with that, like what is the relationship between the scientists who work on the volcano and the local communities? How do they interact? What do they think about each other?
It depends of which scientist actually, but for example, in the observatory of Babadan, there is two people, Indonesian, local, most of the time they are local, and they spend 24 hours in the observatory, so they change. So they know very well the population, and one of the men who came to make meditation inside the observatory, they come from the small village around the observatory, and they know very well with the agent who is in charge of the observation. They know each other very well, they have a friendly relationship, and I think they share maybe a lot of points, cultural point and social point. So after that I can't answer very well about this question because I've not yet studied this kind of relationship. But it's existing. They are not so different. Maybe we can think that in the fact there are so many agents from state agency who have really a close relationship with few people on the volcano, and they are not like a bureaucrat or outside scientists. Some of them are really constructing good relationship with local people, and it's not really like black and white separation. It's more like in the for some of them, it's more like more like a close relationship with the world.
Is it working? Yeah, I've got one remark and one question. Actually, the first remark, I'm not sure we have to sort the dancing and procession ritual in the animism category. Actually, it should be sorted in the ontologism. Since there are the few exceptions, there won't be any technical procession in any animist societies. That's not a very serious approach, just a question of order. The second thing is thinking about, okay, let's take two different ways of identification of beings. First, animism, and then, let's say, naturalism. What would you think in terms of kind of overlapping of the two systems? Would you say that we can say that some scientists have some, let's say, animist crisis when the local people will also adapt ways of thinking that are imposed by the, let's say, naturalist device of observation of risk, because they have to integrate this because of the reset or establishment policies and so on. So they have to adapt to a new situation, a policy which is, among other things, informed by, let's say, a kind of naturalist way of seeing risk. So do you see any overlapping in the two different communities?
Yeah, there is, but actually there's so many missions of socialization from the state's agency among the population to explain what is the volcano and everything, but maybe I should talk here because maybe you have sometimes this overlapping is inside the same person, and I cannot understand how it's when we think about shame of integration of Philippe Descola, we cannot understand how in the way of cognitivism, how is it possible to mix animism and naturalism in the same person. For example, the guardian of the volcano, he really believe in the power of the Volcano Surveillance Agency, but he still believe in dream and everything. I don't know, maybe I didn't really good understand the theory of Philippe Descola, and maybe you can help me to understand how this kind of apparently opposite conception can exist inside the same person.
I guess this is not, I understand, but I live through this kind of troubles every day. I speak to my phone, I speak to my computer, and there's anybody here who speaks with his computer in crisis time. That's why I told you about crisis. But, so maybe the question is not so much about how, as an individual, maybe, I'm not sure, get a lot of fruits. I'm not sure if the question is about how individually we can articulate the two ways of seeing the world, but how big blocks of logics, like Philippe Descola identified, can spread to different populations and mix together. So at the society level, my question was, how can you observe in a, either in this Zenist society and in the local society, different approach from the dominant one? It means that in the scientific world, you should view the risk as something which has nothing to do with human societies, but putting them in a dangerous system. Like you said, no communication device. But at the same time, you tell us that the way to investigate for scientists is to send some messages to the natural elements, the earth or whatever. So what would you say, if you did the reverse, for the local population, what's the way, how do they, as they organize themselves as societies, how do they at the same time lead to a traditional way of behaving toward the environment, the natural environment, and at the same time taking into consideration the fact that this is, because they have a kind of map, there's a map, the two corners, how they mix the two maps you showed us at the end of your presentation. It actually was very, very interesting. How do they go through these two maps at the same time? How can they organize themselves? Do they have some, do they speak about this? We don't speak about what these two maps, but what they represent. Is it at stake in the society, and how?
Yeah. But actually, when I'm in the field, locally, the border of this map zone, it's not clear. People don't know where is the border. When I'm entering in the risk area, they don't know actually. Because there is still people, the neighbor village of Pelopsarani still live in the risk area. So the road is like, there is still house along the road, and the road follows the north-south axis. And there is no sign, nothing about you under in the risk area, so people don't speak about that, actually. They maybe know they live in a dangerous area, but they don't speak about that, and they have no clear idea about where is the border, actually.
They don't know, but at the same time, they have to comply with the idea of how to be settling in the area where they were wedding beforehand.
Yeah. So after, because of some of them still live in a risk area, they can experiment restriction in terms of electricity, of the quality of the road, because they don't want to repair the road. So they can they can feel the restriction in terms of infrastructure. So they can feel it in that way, because this is concrete diminution of service, state service, and everything. But sometimes you don't have signal, communication signal for telephone or something like that. So they can feel it, but the border is not clear.
It's not clear cut.
It's not clear cut.
But when you progress on the volcano, at some point, anybody can realize that.
No.
That there's something happened or not at all.
Yeah, we can. If you are a good observer, you can look at the houses who have been rebuilt. But now, after 5 years, it's become like more and more difficult to know because vegetation have grown up again and house have grown too, so it's becoming more and more difficult to see the separation. But people remember when your house has been destroyed, you remember that. So they remember the risk, they already remember the risk, and maybe just my interpretation, but I think now people don't want to capitalize so much. They make houses in risk area, but houses are not so beautiful, so magnificent, because they know they can lose this house. So it's just small, normal house, and before they really can build big houses, and quite beautiful house, but now it's like they live with enough, as they say. So maybe we can see that, but maybe we have to be have this reflection because I'm outsider observer from inside point of view. I don't think they really interpret that about houses like I interpret it. This is an invisible kingdom who is told like located in the sea actually. So Senopati is the first king of the dynasty of the Matara. It is told that he was visiting his lover Ratukidul by going into the sea, swim and enter in the palace, royal palace of Ratukidul. And this interaction between these two nature is possible only with specific condition or with specific people with specific power. And dreams, most of the time, dreams are the preferred canal for this communication. For example, in the Jakarta city, you have a royal cemetery, the cemetery of Senopati, and every specific calendar day, by night, there are many people who go there to sleep or meditate, and in the hope that they can receive protection and maybe they can receive dream message from their ruler, Senopati. So Yeah, this is the first one of the dynasty, the current dynasty. The dynasty now, Yogyakarta is called Dynasty of Madara. And the first one, this is Senopati. His brain is considered as really powerful, and is still powerful. And this is why people sleep there, close to the cemetery, with the hope to receive some message and good prediction and protection. So I think that dream is really the preferred canal to between these two nature. I don't know if I really answered to the question.
My name is Madame Ramanami, and then thank you for the interesting topic. I have talked with Achandaruma Arunotai. This is actually what was you talking about Java and the interaction between nature, a visible and invisible kingdom is it's not only happened in Java, it's kind of South Asia phenomenon. Phenomena in South Asia, this makes South Asia is an interesting topic. So, but I have a question here about Bangladesh and Bangladesh in 2010 was dead because of he didn't want to move here, yeah, and he believed that I will be safe in a mountain. And then after that, Merapi mountain erupted and he died. So how do you interpret this phenomenon? And then the second is about the naturalist and the local belief. The naturalist using a sophisticated technology to make interact with the phenomena of Merapi mountain, and the local belief using a belief. This is the message, dream. He has a dream and here is the message. That's the message. So how the naturalist and how the local perceive the naturalist, because you know the group of people that use sophisticated technology always influence the local. This is the true one. This is the true one, and this is the belief that you are believe is not really true. Then how the naturalist and then the local interact with the phenomena? Do you get the picture?
With the phenomena of how they interact with
The Merapi mountain. So the Merapi mountain is erupted, and then the naturalist already give them a sign to evacuate, but maybe they don't get the dream. So they.
Yeah, actually, they received the message, and the states in 2010 was really proud because they can give the evacuation order a few hours before the first pyrocosmic flow. And most of the people have evacuated, but it's true, Bamarijan was the former guardian of Volcano who died during this eruption. And have been burned by pyroclastic flow, but nobody has speak to him before he died, and actually there are many interpretations about why he stayed. Even they have already get the evacuation order, and most of people say that Bamarijan is a very devoted servant to the royal palace, And he has been from in the position of Muslim prayer, turn to the volcano, not on the west, to Mecca. So as maybe some people say that he stayed during this eruption because he don't want to miss his principal mission, which is communicate with the volcano. So maybe he just was try to pray and pray to for the safety of Yogyakarta Kingdom because it was his mission from the Sultan. Most of people say that. So he don't want to evacuate maybe because he don't miss his dream, but because he was in charge to establish communication with the volcano. But actually he's already died and nobody knows of what it was sinking during this eruption. I don't know if I answered your question.
How about the locals perceive the naturalism with some mistaken technology?
They live with naturalism, actually. People know very well the logic of the volcano because there are so many session of socialization to volcanic hazard from the state agency, so they have good knowledge and skills about volcano. So it's not really opposite, but it can be just mixed. This is really overlapping, but when we think that some people are making offering to observation seismic station and this kind of thing, it's like they integrated that into their own representation of environment. And I don't know, this is the point I want to discuss with you because I don't know if I make a mistake by interpreting this fact as integration to make to make sense, actually, to make a meaningful world. To maybe this is a strategy of society to mix this both ontology into something or which are not opposed but more like a world. I don't know.
Interesting. How they weigh with different elements of different ontologies, how they make it to work together, because they have to be together, in fact, the volcanologists, the local people, the spirits of the volcano. So how these elements come together, how meaningful elements of their different cosmology can make something which is a kind of new ontology, because it's true that Descola, his book and his ideas of analogism, animism, and naturalism is great structures or model to see possible relation and modes of organization. But we can see that they are mixing. They are not a pure model that you can find somewhere. Even there is big area of influence. And we see Indian Buddhist model. Of course, we are maybe more in an analogist view, world view. As you said, there is also animistic elements. But it's things that we have to question because it's not really clear. And this Southeast Asia, he didn't develop this idea, so, well, it's something that opened new horizons for us too. And we were hoping to discuss with him about this topic.
You have to for me as a question.
Yeah, in November. But I was thinking about the what you said, there is one notion which is maybe important in this mixing of ontologies, or it's maybe not meaningful in the local perception, is the notion of risk. because it's very fashion now to talk about the in development theories about risk management and things like that. So how do the people feel about what is a risk? Do they feel risk? How they express it? And how the education, because they are educated, newly educated about risk, risk of erosion and things like that. So how do they manage with this notion?
Just say that risk is everywhere. Not just like in the volcano, but there is socio-economic risk. They speak about that too, and sometimes it's more important than natural risk. So, but I don't know, it's quite difficult to answer that because it's more like, maybe I can say cultural way of thinking about life is like that. I receive every day the present day and I try to think my future for my children too. I think about risk, but risk is not just the volcanic risk, but then this is everything. This is spiritual risk, the risk of rupture with ancestor, with neighbor, socioeconomic abundance or not, and practice. So it's more like holistic view about life, more than as a management professional, risk management professional, only isolated the natural risk. And they are not involved in the risk with the speaking, as Merapi people are involved in everyday life with this risk. So it's quite different on this point, I think. I don't know, maybe it's not too culturalist perspective. I don't know.
I think that is also central, the concept of risk, because if we follow Stefan's question and Ajahn Manasan's questions about the boundary, the map of boundary of risk, right? The state agency perceives risk as really absolute, on the boundary, whereas the local people, like you said, it's risk is relational and risk is trying to appease, you know, the spirits, having a communication with the volcano instead of, you know, just looking at the big volcano as very dangerous. So you can give offering, you can communicate with the volcano, like Master Moves, you know, negotiate. That's the point of making communication relations, and I think that's very important. And if we come back to the case of the Mogan, the sea nomads, they perceive the tsunami differently than most of us. They don't think that it's a risk. It's a phenomenon that comes once in a while to cleanse the earth. So, you know, it's natural phenomenon, whereas we see it as disaster. So I think the term risk is worthy of consideration in the ecological term, especially if we look through the lens of this book. And I think I have the name of a book for you, How Volcano Think. Yeah. We have How Forest Think, right, as the famous book. So if you write another one about volcano.
But it's true, maybe I don't speak about that, but maybe one can see the tsunami as a cyclic and something was cyclic, and erosion is quite like that. It's something erosion have to happen because this is cyclic time, this is like that. It's always like that. It's a way for the volcano to communicate too. So maybe the temporal dimension is important too, and I didn't develop in this presentation, and maybe we can add this kind of reflection. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I will agree on the what I've been said very deeply. Maybe you are developing this in your thesis writing, but I think what would be very interesting if you have a few minutes just to expose this, the way people we interpret, first, do they have a memory of the old eruption events? Would they interpret differently the casualties which are imposed by either pyroclastic events or lava? These different phenomena do find some different interpretations or not. Is the communication, in the terms of our communication with the volcano, has been efficient or not? Is there a kind of orthopraxy considering the puja offering a way of communicating with the volcano? And so, maybe so the question won't be so much like why the volcano do erupted, but how and how much was the casualty, what was the way of how to say this, what was the way casualties did happen that time, for what kind of reason, and connected to like you said very precisely, and the holistic cosmology that explains in the very basic world.
Every eruptive event are producing a lot of interpretation. Then yes, there is a memory of eruption, and some, not all people, but some of them have told me, for example, for the eruption in 94, the eruption, some people say the eruption happened because there was a wedding in one village who had been destroyed, but the day of the wedding was a sacred day.
What,
a wedding?
Of wedding.
Marriage.
Yeah.
So the day choose for the wedding ceremony was a sacred day. It was a Selasakli one. So then some people say because of that the Merapi volcano was really angry and destroyed the village and actually destroyed the ceremony. So you have this kind of interpretation that if we don't do in a right way, we will have trouble with this nature. So it's happened. But it can be a lot of interpretation. The former guardian of the volcano, this is Jean-Marc, who told me that. The guardian has told after this eruption of 94, so during the Suharto period, he told that the Merapi volcano erupts because politics are doing very wrong mistake and everything like that. So he critiqued political system and for him Merapi volcano is clearly disappointed because of political government. So it depends.
So first, there must be some different interpretation concerning people. The two interpretations you gave us are about two different eruptions or the same one?
The same one.
And the same one. So very interesting.
So it's depends. It's depend on scala, who speak to who, and everything. But I don't know. I didn't really work on this interpretation of volcanic event, but another researcher, a German one, studied the subject. His name is Judith Scheer, and she really showed in this article that she takes several newspaper articles and she is referencing all the interpretation of the same eruption. It's really passionate. It's really incredible. There is can't be, I don't know, maybe people try to make sense with this disruption in time and space. I don't know. But we can see disaster like that. And people really try to make sense, to find a sense. Why? because Boswell wins.
Symmetry.
Do you want to explain the view of Philippe Descola, or why I explain my data as symmetry? So Philippe Descola just say that in analogism there is the significant point that people always try to make correspondences, analogies between the multiplicity of factors, and this analogy can be an illustration of this analogy can be an obsession, almost an obsession for symmetry. And in Merapi volcano, the symmetry is really clear when we consider the axis. North-south axis, in the center the Yogyakarta Palace, and in the south you have one invisible kingdom of the goddess of Indian Ocean, and in the north you have the invisible kingdom of Merapi volcano. We clearly see the symmetry between these two worlds, with at the center, a point of symmetry, the Royal Palace.
You speak about spatial
and temporal.
And temporal, yes. How are the temporal patterns?
It's very complicated because it's about a mixing of calendar in Java between Javanese calendar, Muslim calendar, and Occidental calendar. And they always try to calculate good dates for some event, and this date depends to the distance with other dates, and like that. It's very complicated actually to explain, but they always calculating the distance in a temporal way too. I don't know how to explain that.
Is it related to the Merapi?
When we consider the Labuhan ceremony, so the temporal symmetry exists because of the date of, they choose the date of the accession, the anniversary of accession of the Sultan, of the progressive to the throne, actually. And this is in this dimension. So every anniversary, so every year, it's like this symmetry is like cyclic symmetry. So they repeat every year. Every year they repeat the same ceremony to establishing, in my hypothesis, a symmetry between the repetition of the ceremony and the repetition of the accession to the throne. Do you understand?
The cycle.
Yeah.
The cycle of the accession to the throne. The cycle of the.
Yeah, and the symmetry is here actually, I think.
Okay. Thank you.
I have a comment to.
First of all, the previous the question of risk and the perception of risk, and you said that the eruption was a consequence of human fault, in fact. And it's, I don't know, but in my fieldwork with the current people, you have the same kind of conceptions that what could happen, natural disaster, in fact, all the consequences of human behavior, like the great taboos, and mostly it's about sexual relationships or something like that. So I think it's also something which it's world famine. Mm-hmm. Very pregnant in Southeast Asia.
But what is funny that it's more and more true in naturalism too.
More and more?
True, that disaster are human, have human origin.
Yeah.
So, we can connect many things with that, with the concept of vulnerability. So it's been like society are conscious, constructing and build their own disaster actually. Like climate change and everything like that.
So, thank you very much.
Thank you to you.
And next station.